All right, good morning, boys and girls. It is Friday, May 1st, 2020. Today we're gonna focus on concrete poetry. So let's go over our expectations first. One, make sure that you have a pencil and a packet available. Your pencil's nice and sharp. Your packet's turned to the right page. It's Friday, May 1st, 2020. Also, whenever I say pause the video, please pause your video and fill out whatever section we're working on. When you're finished filling out the section, just unpause the video. So at the end of the video, please complete your exit ticket on Teams. So we're going to spark. It is not Thankful Thursday. It is Family Friday. So think about people. It can be people in your house, it can be your teachers, your someone that you know. Who is someone that has been showing our core values? So our core values, if you forgot, are closing the achievement gap, no excuses, whatever it takes, 100% every day, sweating the small stuff, and then team and family. So for instance, my third grade team, so that means the teachers, have been a strong team and family. So I know that I've had some family problems this week, and then my third grade team have been very supportive and very strong and very helpful to me. So who is someone that you know has been showing one of these core values? So I will give you 1 minute. You for writing in complete sentences, even though you don't have the stem. We start with a capital, with the space in between. I'm sorry, write neatly, a space in between, and then give it punctuation at the end. Who, you can choose any of those core values. Ten more seconds. Awesome. So let's move on to our do now. We're gonna read Boa Constrictor by Shel Silverstein. Answer the questions below. Whenever we see a text, what do we do first? Exactly, we label our text features. So go ahead and label your two text features. It looks like the lines are already numbered, so that's awesome. Yes, that's our title. The title is Boa Constrictor. Then also look at this. We have an illustration over here. What do you notice about the illustration? What do you see? Right, I see a boy and it looks like there's a snake on his foot. Wonder if it's a boa constrictor. Try to think of what this poem could be about. Also, did you know that songs are poems? So this poem, Boa Constrictor, is actually a song. Let me see if I can find you. Someone playing it on their guitar and singing it. While I set this up, trivia. We learned a lot about Shel Silverstein on Monday. What really famous song did he write? If you said A Boy Named Sue by Johnny Cash, you're right. All right, so this man is gonna sing it for you. I want you to track as he sings this poem.
I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor, a boa constrictor, a boa constrictor. I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor, and I don't like it one bit. Well, what do you know? It's nibbling my toe. Oh, gee. It's up to my knee. Oh, my. It's up to my thigh. Oh, fiddle. It's up to my middle. Oh, heck. It's up to my neck. Oh, dread. It's up to my...
I know it's kind of a silly poem. So I want you to take 4 minutes to answer these questions. Go. Five questions. Which rhymes rhyme? If you see some rhyming words at the end of the line, make sure you circle them. That will help you answer question number one. Thank you for going back over your poem and finding those rhyming words. Also, I saw one example of internal rhyme, which is the rhyme within the line. If you can find that, I will give you bonus points. You should be on number 2 by now. Which lines show repetition? Remember, repetition are those repeated words. Why do we even have repeated words in poems? What's the point? What's the purpose? We learned about that this week. 3 says, how does the poem make you feel? Remember that these are your feelings, so you can choose. However, I need you to back it up with text evidence. This poem makes me feel blank because blank. Why do you think the poet wrote this poem? Is he trying to persuade you, the reader, to buy a boa constrictor for a pet? B, inform the reader about the behavior of boa constrictors. C, is he just trying to entertain you with a poem about a snake? Or D, give details of how it feels to be inside of a snake. Why did Shel Silverstein write this poem? Number 5, the last line shows that the snake is up to the speaker's what? You're gonna have to make an inference. Maybe use that line, that rhyme pattern to make an inference. What do you think? Because I don't think is a body part. Okay, you have about 55 more seconds. you should have, let's see, you should have text evidence, you should have those rhyming words circled. I would underline the repetition, find that text evidence. Okay, 20 more seconds. Coming together in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Alrighty. Let's go ahead and check your answers on the Do Now. So which lines rhyme? If you said lines 9 and 10 rhyme, you're right. Let's see. So we know that no and toe rhyme. We know that G and knee rhyme. Thigh, my thigh. Fiddle, middle. Heck, neck. Awesome. Those are your lines that have that end rhyme. Who did the extra credit? And they found that internal rhyme, the rhyme within the line. If you said line 6, or it says, and I don't like it one bit. Which words show internal rhyme, the rhyme within that one line? Exactly, it and bit. Good. So which lines show repetition? If you said B, lines 3 and 4, a boa constrictor, you're right. Why is it repeated over and over again? Remember that repetition shows that it's very important. Why is a boa constrictor important? Exactly, that's the topic of this poem, the boa constrictor. And look, he's eating that little boy. Number 3, how does the poem make you feel? So I said this poem makes me feel scared. Why? Because he's getting eaten by a boa constrictor. It's like, this looks scary to me personally, because a boa constrictor is eating the speaker. My text evidence is right here. I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor. Straight up, that sounds scary. That's on line 5. All right, why do you think the poet wrote this poem? If you think it's to entertain, see, you're right, it's just for fun. All right, number 5, the last line shows the snake is up to the speaker's what? It went from its toes to its knee, to his thigh, to his middle, to his neck. Where do you think he is? What rhymes with dread? You're right, you're so smart. His head. Good inference. Okay, so let's go ahead and move on to our objective. Student will be able to identify and create the structure of a poem. So remember that structure is how the poem is built, circle built. Structure appeals to the reader's sense of sight. Good, draw some eyeballs. So we're gonna read the poem, Circle Road by Shel Silverstein. Go ahead and label your text features before we read. We have the title, and we have this illustration of a little man. Oops, sorry. What do you notice about the structure of this poem? How is it built? You're right, it's in a circle, and it's called Circle Road. That's interesting. So let's go ahead and read. Let's start where the little man is walking, go ahead and track. I started here. I go down Circle Road, strong and hopeful, hearted, through the dust, and wind up just exactly where I started. And then you could say it again if you wanted to. Why? Because it's endless. It's a circle. So, read the poem Circle Road. What shape is this poem in? Yep, it is in a circle. So how does this shape help you better understand the poem? The circle shape better helps you understand the poem because circles are what? Because one is called Circle Road, but two, circles are endless. And so is this poem. Which to me, I think is pretty clever. All right, would the poem make sense if it was displayed in a square? Why not? If it was like this, would it make sense? The poem would not make sense because the title is what? Circle Road. So it must be built like a what? A circle. All right, let's go ahead and go to the back. We have two activities on the back. So we're gonna read another poem called Lazy Jane, and then you're gonna write your own poem about someone that you know. So go ahead and label your text features. So we know this is a title. And what's the title again? Good, Lazy Jane. Look at this girl. Does she look lazy to you? Maybe. Let's label this illustration. Why does she look lazy? Because her mouth is open. She's like laying down. Yeah, that looks a little lazy. Let's figure out why she's lazy. But first, we need to label our lines. See if you can beat me. There's a lot of lines in this poem. Awesome. Wow. You should have 28 lines and then there's one big old stanza. Alrighty. Let's go ahead and track. Lazy Jane. Lazy, 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 lazy Jane. She wants a drink of water, so she waits and waits and waits and waits and waits and waits for it to rain. All right. So, before you create your own poem, I do want you to answer some questions. So it says, number the lines, which we did, and Lazy Jane. Use the poem Lazy Jane to answer the following questions. So at this moment, I'm going to ask you to pause. Pause your video so you can answer these questions. For me, it took me about 5 minutes. So when you're finished, unpause your video. Go ahead and pause. Awesome, I bet you made a 100 on that little quiz. Let's talk about the poem we're writing today. So, we're gonna brainstorm first. Write a poem about someone you know. Who can you write about? Someone in your life. You can write about your mom. You can write about one of your teachers. You could even write about one of your friends. Anyone you want. So I'm going to write about Miss Gill. She is one of my friends. She will be your fifth grade teacher one day. And I need to put a period at the end. Okay, how would I describe this person in three words? At least three words. If you can think of more, good for you. Kiss your brain, you're so smart. So when I think of Miss Gill, I think she's super funny. She's also really loud. Let's see, she's kind. She always tries to spread kindness. I want to go above and beyond, so I'm just going to add a couple more bullet points to my list. I know Miss Gill is super smart. She's a leader. And also, she's super loving to her family and her students. So take 10 more seconds to brainstorm what your person is like. If you need to pause the video, then you can. Okay, so it says we brainstormed a couple of describing words, some adjectives for Miss Gill. Then it says, what words rhyme with the person that you're writing about? I know that whenever I try to think of rhyming words, my first step is to write the alphabet on top. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. I actually got inspired by this idea from a very famous rapper, because you know raps rhyme. And his name rhymes with Shmiminim. All right. But yes, rhyming can help, and this is a very good strategy that you can use. All right, so I went through the alphabet and came up with a list of words that rhyme with Miss Gill. And this is the list I came up with. Woof, there are 15 things on this list, just because I went through the entire alphabet. But you would need to do this with what rhymes with your person's name. You can pause your video if you need to. But I'm gonna move on in 10 seconds so I can help you, or so I can show you what it looks like. What words rhyme with your person's name? For Gill, I chose shrill. Out of all 15 of my words, I just chose shrill because I thought it was funny. And also, shrill is a synonym for loud. But so this is the poem I made up. So let's see. I'm gonna borrow how Shel Silverstein kind of made the structure of Lazy Jane. So I'm gonna call this Shrill Gill. There's about 28 lines in this poem, so I'm just gonna number it to 28. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. I'm gonna make two columns just because I write big, and that is okay. I'm the poet, right? All right. So how did I just... First of all, how did Shel describe Jane? He described her as lazy. How many times did he repeat lazy? All the way to line 6. So I'm going to say do the same thing with shrill. Shrill. You use whatever adjective you decided. How would you describe your person? All right, 7. Oh, sorry. And then 7, it says Jane. So I'm gonna put Gil. Eight. Let's see. She wants. What does she want? What does Miss Gill want? She wants to be loud. So what does she do in order to be loud? I know that at dismissal, she yells on her megaphone. If you've seen her before, outside with her blue megaphone when she's with sibling pickup. She yells. Oh, she yells and yells. And yells. How many times does Shel? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3. I need to do it 2 more times. So what do we have so far? Shrill, Gil. She wants to be loud. So she yells. That makes more sense. So she yells. And yells and yells and yells. Let's see. On her shiny blue megaphone. Okay, so did I need to use all 28 lines? No. Did I use a describing word to describe my topic, Miss Gill? Yes. Did I introduce Miss Gill? Yes. Did I say what she wants and use repetition? Sure. So it's all up to you. Remember, you're the poet. So you can write this about one, whoever you want. You do not have to follow the structure. But it does, if you're like, oh, I don't know how to write a poem, I don't even know where to start, you can borrow Shel Silverstein's structure for Lazy Jane. If you have any questions, please let me know. Oh, I forgot one thing. We're doing illustrations today. So I'm going to cross this out because I don't need it. If that's why we write in pencil. I'm gonna draw, I forgot the fun part. I can draw a shrill Miss Gill. Like how he drew Lazy Jane, I'm definitely gonna draw shrill Miss Gill on the bottom. She's yelling on her megaphone. And I can even make this what she's saying in her megaphone if I want to be super creative. So yeah, it's your turn to make your own poem. If you need help, please let me know. You can get on Blue Jeans or message me on Teams, whatever you're comfortable with. All right, y'all have a great day and a wonderful weekend.